So yeah, talking about the extremely slow and steady approach to weight loss. So let's jump right into it. So quick recap, why might we be trying to lose weight or body fat in the instance? Typically, reasons for weight loss fall into three very simple camps. Number one is health, number two is performance, and number three is aesthetic. Sometimes people are trying to get all three of those. You know, I put health at the top of that because no matter whether we're trying to improve our performance or improve our aesthetics, we don't want to violate the health rule we don't want to do things that are so deleterious to our overall health that we either can't come back from them or they have such a degrading effect that, you know, we end up getting breakdown of our other systems. You know, we screw up our metabolism and we get a spike in stress hormones and that kind of stuff. So as I said, I put health at the top because performance ultimately comes after that. Your good performance will likely come from good health, and aesthetics is going to come from training, which is probably good performance, and again, health. If you want good aesthetics long-term, you can't do something that's going to basically break down your body and not allow you to train very hard and mess up your relationship with food. So depending on your reasons for weight loss or fat loss, the level of specificity of your goal, one of the following approaches might serve you better than the other. So again, we talked last week about the fast approach and who that might serve. This week, we'll talk about the slow and steady approach. So let's discuss the pros and cons of the slow and steady approach for today. So the cons, ultimately, there are very few cons around this approach. This approach, however, might be best for you if you have, number one, a large amount of weight to lose, and we'll talk about why. Or number two, if you have a past history of extreme or disordered eating. Okay, so whether you've had a history of yo-yo dieting, whether you've had a poor relationship with food in some variation, way, shape, or form, this approach might be a better option for you. So why? You know, the cons of this approach, number one is probably going to be time. Time-wise, this approach takes the longest to achieve a particular set goal. So weight loss might be really slow, and that could be hard to kind of adhere to long-term. Psychologically, it can be quite difficult for you to take this really slow and incremental approach because maybe we, as human beings, we definitely want more quicker. That's not necessarily the way the world works. So I've been told, and so is my basic experience in my 33 years on the planet. Anything that's worth having is probably worth applying some consistent effort and adherence to over the long term. So bear that in mind. So I mentioned a little bit about this goal might be useful for you if you have a large amount of weight to lose. If you do have a large amount of weight to lose, specifically fat, to improve your overall health and quality of life, the likelihood is that any adjustment to a calorie or any adjustment that leads to a calorie deficit is going to be a great start, and you'll get immediate results. So even if it's not quickly, you will get results very quickly. So I think the technical term is like, if we are over fat, if we have more body fat than is necessary, the way we got there is highly likely the way we've got there is, and I mean like 99.9% of the cases here, highly likely the way we've got there is by creating a calorie surplus, basically eating more than we're expending. And any change on that, literally anything, it doesn't have to be extreme, but any change in towards a deficit there will obviously help us lose body fat. And the more body fat we've got, typically the easier it is for us to lose it. So this approach is very useful there. We don't need to make extreme changes to see results when we have a good amount of weight to lose in the short haul initially, all right? So moving on. Yes, it can be a little bit hard and maybe a little bit disheartening if we're not getting immediate results. However, you know, physiologically, it can be a little bit more difficult and somewhat deleterious to be in a calorie deficit for a really long time. So just as it's extreme to go one end of the scale and go from eating 3,000 calories a day to eating 500 calories a day, but that's too extreme, you know, it's maybe not extreme enough to go from... Let's say we've gone from 2000 calories to 1950 calories. That's maybe not extreme enough. So number one, I'm going to get really slow results. I am going to get them, but I'm going to get really slow results, which means that over the long term, it's going to be harder for me to adhere to. Physiologically, however, if we're constantly in a calorie deficit, we never actually give ourselves time to be able to recover some of our other more our metabolic systems. Also is going to limit our energy output. And what I mean by that is if I'm constantly in a calorie deficit, I can never really perform to a really high level. And all I'm going to do is just gradually lower my bar for output, right? So we need to be able to periodize our diets in terms of and this is maybe a bit more of a long-term approach, but we need to be able to periodize our diets in times of isocaloric, which is staying the same, hypercaloric, going more calories and being able to build more muscle and basically just increase our overall capacity by building more muscle mass, and then hypocaloric, and when we work a little bit lower on the calories and we try and burn body fat for energy, right? So we want to be able to kind of periodize between those three stages of body composition change or body fat reduction. So bear that in mind as we go through all three of these. Staying in a hypercaloric diet is going to encourage us to just gain weight long term. Staying in a hypocaloric diet is going to, yes, it's going to help us lose weight long term, but if we're forever in a hypocaloric state, at some point we're going to get a degrading effect on some of our other metabolic systems. So moving on to the pros of this, there's far more pros than there are cons, and we'll kind of go through them now. So as I just mentioned, we're most likely going to benefit from periodizing our diet in the same way that we periodize our training, right? If you just go hard in the gym all the time and you try and train at 100% all the time, you're not actually training at 100%, right? If you redline your car every time you go to the shops, you're just going to gradually just wear down your car. You're not actually going to be able to redline it anymore. And what is redlined when it's a brand new car is not going to be redlined when it's 6 months old. It's just not going to have the same level of control and capacity of it. Okay. So we want to have a phasic approach to our training, and we want to have a phasic approach to our dieting as well. As I said, this is likely a very good option if either A, you're new to dieting, if you're new to trying to drop body fat and make body composition changes, or you have a history of extreme or disordered eating, the slow and steady approach, not changing too many things at once, is most likely a very useful way to do things. So psychologically, though this approach can be hard to adhere to because progress might be slow initially, moving at a slow pace, as I just said, allows us to build behavioral changes into the process, making sure that we understand both why and how we can make efficient nutritional choices. So what I mean by that is, if you have ever tried to break a habit, let's say, for example, you've tried to, kick smoking. Very few people do very well with cold turkey. Most of the time we want to see people just reduce the amount of cigarettes they have on a given day. Maybe it's not cigarettes, maybe it's, Coke, or by Coke, I mean Coca-Cola, not cocaine. But maybe it's, sugary drinks. Maybe it's chocolate. If you ever tried to give something up for Lent or something like that, it's really hard to go cold turkey. And we've talked in previous weeks about, if you do go cold turkey and you just stop eating something, the next time you see that thing, it becomes incredibly seductive. And the next time we eat it, it's super, super hyper palatable. So we don't want to just try and change everything all at once. We want to make slow incremental changes and see if we can manage them in the short term before we then add on the next layer, right? So that's psychologically, we want to be able to build in behavior changes, because behavior is ultimately the thing that controls everything that we do, no matter how hard we try, no matter how hard we tell ourselves, willpower is going to get me through. Without behavior change, you've got no chance. So physiologically, although this approach is a bit more of a slow burner, if you recognize yourself as A, an anxious person, or someone who's averse to change, so in general, I'm a relatively anxious person, I can deal with change, but I have to have a ton of planning with it, the slow and steady approach is a clear winner here, because if we change everything all at once, just as I just said, like, the likelihood of us being able to control that many variables, that many plates that are spinning, it's not likely going to be doable. So instead, what we want to do is trying to make some small, doable goals, some achievable goals week to week. And that could be something as simple, it doesn't have to be this, but that could be something as simple as just eating one vegetable a day, right? That might be as much as any one person could tolerate in terms of change, in terms of, adding on a new behavior. But that is the first stepping stone, right? You can't just jump into doing, hey, I'm never going to eat chocolate again. I'm only going to eat broccoli now, because they're too far removed. They're too extreme. And the likelihood of you being able to adhere to that is slim to none. You're going to white knuckle it and then probably crash. That's what we see. That's what experience tells us. So, trying to change every variable all at once is not a great idea. And that doesn't matter whether you're experienced or not experienced, just doesn't matter. So, again, this approach might be a little bit more manageable for you if you're a relatively anxious person or averse to change. And you can make your own mind up as to what I mean by anxious person. I don't mean, you have to be shaking and quaking in your boots and you don't want to go outside. But at the same time, if you think like, hey, I've got so many things going on right now that if I just try and do, you know, just that one little thing with my nutrition, you know, it's going to tip me over the edge, then we need to find a smaller, more doable step, right? It's just, you know, we all eat a pizza the same way, one slice at a time, right? We all run a marathon the same way, one step at a time. We're just going to work out how big those steps are, how big that slice of pizza is, to pardon the pun. So it's the same with everything. You know, if we try to overhaul our training, try to overhaul our nutrition, our sleep, our lifestyle preferences, and our behaviors all at once, you know, that's a surefire way to get overwhelmed and end up doing probably nothing, which is what we see every single year for the New Year's resolution, right? People think, this is my year. They're not thinking that in 2020, but January 1st, they're like, I'm going to do it. This is what I'm going to do. I'm going to go to the gym 5 days a week, even though right now I don't have a gym membership. I'm going to only eat chicken and rice, even though right now I only eat two meals a day, and one of those is cereal. I'm going to get 9 hours sleep, even though right now I've got a really stressful job and I only sleep 5.5 hours. I'm going to give up drinking, even though right now I've got a really sociable schedule and, you know, I drink 5 nights a week. That's too many things to try and close the loop on, and ultimately people end up lasting for 2 weeks and then don't do anything anymore, right? They just kind of fall off. So we want to make sure that the any changes that we do, that we can manage them. And some people are going to be able to make more or bigger changes in any given moment, and we'll talk about that next week a little bit more when it comes to kind of like the moderate approach, which is right in the middle of this, which is where most people will fall. You know, the first week's approach, we talked about being fast and quite aggressive in our weight loss. That's a very experienced approach, and most people who have experience with dieting are going to be capable of doing it. It's not going to be easy, but they are going to be capable of doing it. This is far more of a beginner's approach, and I don't say beginner as a slight. Beginner is a compliment. Take it as a compliment in the fact that if you're a beginner, everything's new. Everything's radically not easy, but simple. And simple is the foundation. You'll always want simple. The moment it starts getting really difficult, you're probably off track a little bit. So being a beginner is actually super useful, and it's a place we all want to be, right? We can all make those newbie gains no matter what we're trying to do. So continuing with the pros here, consistent adherence is the ingredients that we all need, no matter the goal. You know, the slow and steady approach allows us to take stock of all the necessary variables, all the necessary plates that are spinning at any given moment. And we're able to decide, you know, what do I want to work on? What's the low hanging fruit? What's the easiest thing for me to do? So I actually work with a nutrition client at the moment, and her weekends are super sociable. You know, it's garden parties and it's beer gardens and there's White Claw and there's pizza and there's chicken wing. Now that's just too big of a task for us to tackle. So instead what we do is we just say, okay, Monday through Friday, do you have any of those things going on? No? Okay, well, what can we do Monday through Friday? What's the low hanging fruit? What's the smallest possible change that yields the biggest possible result in terms of being able to get big bang for our buck, no matter what we do, whether it's training, nutrition, sleep, doesn't matter. Targeting the low-hanging fruit for as long as possible. That's, again, like the beginner's approach. That's what we want to do for as long as possible, right? The better the grasp we have on what's going on in collaboration with working on any single behavior until they've stuck is a surefire way to build new behaviors long-term. So what I mean by that is, you know, I want to make a change, stick with it for a couple of weeks or until I feel like, you know what, I can do this without any major effort. Like, you know, let's say, for example, you're trying to just get up earlier. Getting up early one day and then thinking, actually, that's it. Bring me on to the next one. Bring me on to the next habit. Now I'm going to get up early and I'm going to go to the gym. Actually, just start by trying to get up early. Try and get up early consistently. Can you nail that behavior before you start adding on layers onto the top of it? Because before you know it, you know, if you move beyond the behavior before you've nailed it down, you actually don't know what's working. There's too many variables for us to deal with, right? So we want to make sure, and there is no magic number, but we want to make sure that we can at least do a behavior for maybe a week, 2 weeks before we say, okay, feel ready to add that next layer on now, right? So you've probably heard in the past, it takes 3 weeks to build a habit, or it takes 3 weeks to break a habit. Some people are going to be more capable than others, but it's about which variables go into building those habits in the first place. You know, habits can take shape and take hold really easily if the environment that we're trying to build for them is kind of matched with that habit. But if I say to you, hey, you're going to get, you know, if you say to me, sorry, you're going to try and get up at 6 a.m., I'm going to say, okay, what time do you go to bed? Because if you go to bed at 2 a.m, there's no chance you're getting up at 6 a.m, right? So it's not the act of getting up early, it's all the other things around it, right? It's what the contributing factors that go into building that behavior. So in summary, this is, you know, there's great progress to be made in this approach. If you're new to weight loss, if you're new to the weight loss process, or you have a history of disordered eating, or you're maybe a little bit more change averse. Now, what I mean by disordered eating is just that if you've tried to change too many things in the past, and potentially you've had a lot of yo-yo diets and you've gone back and forth and you've tried lots of different phasic kind of fat, not fad diets in a bad way, but like the different approaches to diets and you don't feel like anything is stuck, you know, the likelihood is that most of those fad diets come with a time cap on them. They say, lose 10 pounds in 10 days, drop a gene size in a month. Like everything is time bound and behaviors aren't necessarily time bound, which is exactly what we just said. And what we need to make any of those changes stick is long-term behavior change. So the slow and steady approach really builds up that behavior change much better than the kind of white knuckle, hold on, be really aggressive with your weight loss. That approach works really well if you've got all the tools and you know how to build them into a well-rounded approach. Most people don't. The people who know how to do that are typically bodybuilders or people who work in combat training for combat sports and need to make weight. And even those people still come out with some pretty broken down relationships with food. So, you know, the fast and aggressive approach is not for everybody, especially when it's touted for everybody every January. You can do this in this amount of time. Okay, well, try and help me build a little bit more. Try and help me say, you can do this in this amount of time and do it long term. That's when behavior change comes in. And that's maybe where this approach is a little bit more beneficial. So, you know, this approach is neither for advanced or beginners. No matter what we do, I'd like to highlight this again, no matter what we're doing, no matter how experienced we are, no matter our training age, no matter our experience with dieting or food in general, you know, consistent adherence and evaluation of what we're doing is what's key to making progress. And I'll say that again, consistent adherence and then consistent evaluation of the process that we're using is what is key to making progress. So no matter what you do, try and build this habit that's going to last you long-term, right? Again, I use the phrase of like, we don't want to be white-knuckling it. We don't want to create an environment that's so extreme that we just want to jump away from it. So the analogy that I'll end up using next week is the boiling the frog analogy. Now, you've probably heard this before, and if you haven't, stick with me for a second. The rule goes that if you put a frog in boiling water, it will jump out. If you put a frog in cold water, you can turn up the heat around it, you can boil it without it noticing. Now, what I mean by that is we want to create an environment that's so manageable, so livable that we can just turn up the volume, turn up the heat around us without ever getting so extreme that we think, shit, this is too much, I have to leave, right? So next week, we'll talk about that approach, which is the more moderate approach, which is, you know, trying to get into some lukewarm water and then gradually ramp up the heat around us without ever creating such an extreme environment that we want to try and leave. So that's kind of the middle ground of the fast and the slow approach. And we'll discuss how to identify the most ideal variables to adjust within that time frame, right? So we can't just say, okay, well, this week I'm going to try and change this. We need to try and have a mechanism by which we say, okay, what's the simplest possible thing for me to do? So oftentimes I'll end up asking people, okay, if the goal is to create, for example, a calorie deficit, what do you feel like you can do right now? Can you move a little bit more or can you eat a little bit less? Can you move a little bit more or can to create a calorie deficit or can you eat a little bit less to create a calorie deficit? Which is the most viable option for you? Can you do a little bit of both? And that's when we'll get into making this the middle ground kind of work for us, okay? So I know it's a little earlier than usual. That was the plan. Thank you for your time. Thank you for your attention. I'll see you the same bad time, same bad place next week for the last installment of a nutrition workshop before we go into a little hiatus. I'm absolutely sweating, boiling in the gym. Have a wonderful day.